Hogan, we coming for you, nigga.
Oh, here, here we go.
Come on, man. Now you know this gotta be on video, right? Oh, man. Said, quarantine bay.
Right. I wish. I was like, oh, what's this virtual screen do? Oh, okay. Yeah.
Oh, I was going to work it out too. My stomach already hurt.
I was like, yeah, go ahead and hit record now. You might be laughing your ass off as soon as I pop in.
Oh, that was totally worth it. Now every time I look up, I'll be like,
I was like, oh, it's got to be hard for him to do the show. It's like, why is Marty Bell in the damn picture?
Hey, it would be funny if you had a slideshow. So the slideshow, like every like 2 minutes, you just like slide over it. It's another picture. Just like it, like randomly go through her Instagram. Instagram. Top of one of those pictures.
Shout out to you, Marty Bell. You are my favorite women wrestler as we speak, and you are my Zoom background for our wonderful, illustrious podcast.
You are my Zoom background. Come take me up tonight. Quarantine Bay.
Hey, just go out to Twitter and be like, hey, Marty Bell, Steve, look at this dude that put you out here.
You know this is going to be the cover for the show, right?
Yeah. Hold on, wait.
That's it. That's it right there. That's a snapshot. I hope when I download this video off Zoom, I hope that's the screen cap that it picks. I want Zoom to pick that as the screen cap.
Like, yeah.
Yeah. Yep, that's the name of the episode.
Yeah.
Right there.
Yeah. Oh, man, I knew you was going to be hurting when you saw that shit.
Oh,
cause,
man.
Because I was sitting here laughing my ass off looking at the preview.
Oh, man. Yeah, that's going to happen. That's going to happen.
So, I know we're in our pre-show, but we do have a new segment that I'm not going to reveal yet. Uh-oh. I'm not going to reveal yet.
Okay.
But stay tuned, everybody.
I'm looking forward to it. I was just like, uh-oh, we got a new segment today? Uh-oh.
Yes, we do.
All right. And now,
I'm going to just put it out there right now. Excuse me for the long intro, because it's a very long intro. It's like the longest intro. But Ray, you will appreciate it. You will definitely appreciate this intro.
All right, bet. I'm down.
We'll definitely appreciate it. That's about as much as this, you know.
You look back at it. Why you look?
Why? After we win, and after we take that Kruger and the Giant, we want the gold, sucker. Hulk Hogan, we coming for you, nigga. For you, nigga.
We take what we want. We the realest in the business. We want the gold sucker.
Hulk Hogan.
We coming for you, no. We take what we want. We the realest in the business. We want the gold sucker.
Hulk Hogan.
We coming for you, no. We take what we want. We the realest in the business. We want the gold sucker.
Hulk Hogan.
We coming for you, no. We take what we want. We're real in the business. We want to go suck.
Hulk Hogan!
We come for you, no come for me. No podcast like this. Black dudes with an act for wrestling. They ain't gotta act cool. They that never bash fool. And they nasty dudes get a show and act a fool on it. Talk smack then put the whole room on it. Fueled by shots and bruise your ass is doomed to award if you want it. Lifelong fans with an honest mission. Get mania ticks without a mission. Nothing but a press pass. This barbershop talk with the best laughs. Bless that we rambling on and you listen. No, we know we got a couple of screws missing. Now who with the two dudes with the cool vision? And we coming for you, nigga.
Well, welcome everyone to the We Coming For You cast.
Oh, man. Oh, my God. Yeah, man, we back, man. We back. Rated R is over here chilling with his quarantine bae in the Zoom chat.
In the Zoom chat. Yes, I am. The Miss Marty Bell of NWA Wrestling. You know, I just figured out how to use the Zoom chat, you know. And she wanted to be in it, so. Welcome.
Would you like to comment on anything, Marty Bell? Oh, God. Well, I guess that's a no. We're going to move on, then. First and foremost, y'all, I am RVS. Oh. That is Franchise 06, Instagram, Twitter, FRANCHICE 06. Hit me up on that. This is the man, Rated R. Where can they find you at, brother?
You can find me on all social media platforms at R, the number 8, TED underscore R. And this is the We Coming For You cast. What is this, episode 18?
Man, it's either going to be 19 or 20 or a mixture of both.
That sounds good. That sounds good.
We recorded one episode, got it in the can, and then a whole bunch more shit happened in the world of pro wrestling. So
yeah.
I might just splice them all together and we just go call episode 19. We just going to skip 19 and go straight to 20.
Right. Hold up. We talk about my background. Is that an Oregon Trail shirt? Is that an Oregon Trail shirt?
It is. It's an Oregon Trail inspired shirt, right?
Yes.
So it's actually a work shirt.
Okay.
So I can't tell you who the client is because that's a secret.
However,
if you can see by the shirt, it is the person on the Oregon Trail.
Uh-huh.
They have their cart, uh-huh. And then they also have their horse.
Okay.
They're literally putting the cart
before the horse.
See, there's one thing about my job that I appreciate is the fact that we talk shit about some of our clients and they're okay with it because they're like, hey man, y'all do good work. We know we're difficult.
Right.
So we just be like, hey man, sometimes they just do things out of order. And they be right. Like, and they just be like, oh man, that's cool. I like that.
Right.
So yes, it is an Oregon Trail inspired shirt, work shirt.
Right. That's what's up. That's what's up. Well, yeah, we already off the rails now, people. We'd already started. I didn't, you know, brought my imaginary guest, you know.
But she's real in our hearts.
She's real in our hearts. Yes. Yes, she is. Yes, she is.
Well, we're just going to go ahead and get into the news and the world, the crazy, wild world of pro wrestling.
Oh, yeah. Y'all probably already know who getting that John Jones Memorial Freedom Award.
God.
You already know.
Oh, my God.
If you had to guess who's getting it.
If you had one ear to the street, you don't even need both ears to
both.
The street this week. If you had one ear to the street this week, you know who getting that award. There ain't no question.
And it sucks that we got to give it to him, man.
Hey man, you out here bad in that way. You need that award. You need a little bit more than
this
that
is
award.
True. This is true.
We ain't gonna talk about that right now. We gonna get into the news.
The news. Let's get into it.
No. We almost can't waste no time. But before we get into the news, before we get into the real news of the day, first and foremost, we got to say, rest in peace to Howard Finkel.
Yeah, man.
Late, great Howard Finkel, man. WWF announcer. Apparently the first employee at WWF. So he was out there announcing folks, and then he was also, you know, sending folks their contracts and all that good stuff.
Bro, he's literally one of the voices of our childhoods. I mean,
absolutely.
When you turned into to WWE, WWFE, when we were in kids, Howard Finkel was the voice you heard. That was it, bro. Like, I'm happy that we had an opportunity to hear him call a few matches. We've heard him call some Undertaker matches at 27. And I think we heard him call some matches at Raw, too, I think, when we saw some SmackDowns we went to. But shout out to prayers out to him and his family. And, you know, just prayers out to everybody, man. This we still in this pandemic, man. It's tough out here, man. I've had friends that lost their loved ones and fathers. And if you're hearing this in the sound of my voice, dog, we coming for you, Cass. Our thoughts and prayers out to you. Keep your head up. Stay clean. Wash them hands. And, man, just God ain't going to put you into a situation that you can't handle. So just keep your heads up and just remember that.
Absolutely. And hopefully, you know, just with, you know, one of the small benefits of things like this, where it's not a whole lot of benefits going with the doom and gloom of everything going on. But it's really helped us a lot, too, because it's just like we're able to come together and talk about pro wrestling, the thing that decided not to stop throughout this whole thing. And, man, for that. If y'all taking the time to listen to us for that, man, we appreciate y'all.
Yep. Kick your feet up, get you a drink, get ready to get entertained, because we got some shit to get into.
So, without further ado, man, hey, let's get into it, bro. Let's start from the top. Let's start from the tippity top, because since the last time, since before WrestleMania, also, if y'all listen to the WrestleMania Watch Along, man, we appreciate that. We got four parts of it, so we got more of it coming. But right after that, the state of Florida, I'm pretty sure a lot of people have heard of this, but the state of Florida has deemed World Wrestling Entertainment an essential business.
Essential. Like, you can't live without it.
Yeah, we talk about grocery stores. We talk about Walgreens, CVS, Dwayne Reed, if you got one of them. We talk about Walmart, Ventures, Kmart. All essential businesses and all on that level, restaurants, if they have takeout only, and then we got World Wrestling Entertainment. We got World Wrestling Entertainment on the same level.
Essential. Can't live with it, can't live without it.
So, exactly right. We can't live without our WWE right now.
Apparently.
So. So there's like a few things, you know, going behind the scenes of that whole thing. And it's like, I got my Truly in my hand because it's about to get real deep as I talk about it. So I'm going to have to take swigs into it. This ain't even no shout out to Daryl, man. This isn't even a conspiracy brother topic. What if we say this right now?
C add 12 divided by the pie. Take 12, and then you add another 12 from the time that it took from Vince McMahon to announce that. You know what that is? 24. Kobe.
But guess what? Linda in this too. We got Linda now.
You take 12, and then you add the 12 because that was the time that Vince McMahon decided to make himself essential. That's the time it came out, Eastern time. Right. 12 plus 12, you know what that is? 24, Kobe.
Kobe. Oh, see? It all revolves around Kobe. But now we got an extra cog in the wheel. See, if you ain't sleep, if you stay woke, you can see who the extra cog in the wheel is. And that cog in the wheel, that name is Linda.
That is
Linda.
True.
See. Let me break it down for you. Let me pontificate for a second on this, right?
Pontificate.
So you got you. I'm gonna pontificate, and then we gonna conversate after that. You know what I mean? That's what we about to do. So check this out. So you got Linda McMahon, right? She was the head of the Small Business Council for Trump, right? The Small Business Council, right? Yes. She resigns from that. And what does she do after that? She becomes the head of one of the Trump super PACs to reelect him in 2020, right?
Right. So she is the head. She is the money, the purse strings. you understand me? The purse strings on this Trump super PAC, right?
Well.
So what she does? So what she does after that is that we have this pandemic, right?
The pandemic.
We have this pandemic.
If you will. Right?
If you will, right? She has her business. They record a bunch of stuff, WrestleMania. They record a bunch of weeks of television after that. And Vince McMahon decides, you know what? I don't want to show none of that on TV. I want to go live every week. So what does Linda McMahon do? She takes the money from the Trump Super PAC and gives $11.8 million to the state of Florida.
Well,
and what the governor of Florida say?
Well, what did he say?
He said, keep the party going. World Wrestling Entertainment is an essential business. Right up there. Ain't even no conspiracy. It's all on the books. Open your eyes, baby. We woke over here.
I was trying to find some church music for the pastor to go off. I can't find it.
And then you give the money to the governor of Florida. And then he say the WWE is an essential business. Y'all don't hear me. The doors of the performance center are open.
The doors of the performance center are open. Please come on in. if you feel like them sandbags and make your legs feel great today, go ahead and join WWE today.
So not only that, so okay, WWE is deemed an essential business in the state of Florida, so they can keep filming their shows.
Sure.
So here's the meat and potatoes of the big stuff that's been happening this week in pro wrestling.
Right.
A day after being considered an essential business and having essential workers of let me break it down for this again. I had to come back to it. Let me break down the words in this essential business. We got World Wrestling Entertainment. Not World Entertainment. Not Entertainment World. World Wrestling Entertainment. So what do? They turn around and fire 20 wrestlers.
Keep going, conspiracy brother.
They fire 20 wrestlers. 20. Wait a minute. Is that The Rock? Yeah. Keep that rolling. You see? Oh yeah, here we go. I can get down to this one. You see, they fired 20 wrestlers. And that group of wrestlers is Kurt Angle, Rusev, Drake Maverick, aka Rockstar Spud. They get rid of Zack Ryder. Zack Ryder, who's been there for 14 years? Uh-huh. All this time? Z-True Hollywood Story, they get rid of Zack Ryder. They get rid of Kurt Hawkins. Team Edge gone.
Been there forever, dog.
Edge just came back. Team Edge gone.
He gone.
Now the next
future endeavor.
What's up?
The future endeavor.
They got future endeavors. We wish you the best in your future endeavors in the middle of this pandemic where we know you can't practice the craft that you are employed to do all the time. That is essential to this business,
this conspiracy brother and the news is going, they all running into each other, because it's really what I wanted to talk about, man. And I damn near almost want to get this man the award too. Ooh. He ain't got it yet.
right. Yeah, you dang, he really don't got the award. How doesn't Vince have the award yet?
Give him an award at all yet. And I don't know how we haven't done that.
Yeah, we're gonna have to table that and come right back to it. Yep. Hold up. Yeah, we're coming back to it. Now these next two names are really messed up. We got Carl Anderson and Luke Gallows got released.
Don't understand that one, dog. You lost me with that one.
They were just in the Boneyard match with Undertaker versus AJ Styles, which means technically that them dying is canon.
For real.
That Undertaker literally killed Gallows and Anderson, and now they ain't going to be seen no more. It's the same thing. Undertaker did the exact same thing to Muhammad Hassan.
Yeah.
I want you to think that. Think about that for a second. Gallows and Anderson got Muhammad Hassan.
Apparently, he did the same thing as New Jack, too.
Man, oh man, that one don't make no sense. That one don't even make no sense. But check this out. We also got Heath Slater.
Man, I hate that one. The only person 3MB that ain't got no championship.
Not yet, because he has completed the first step to coming back and winning the championship. First step for Jinder Mahal and Drew McIntyre was to get fired. The next step he needs is to do a little juice, do just a little bit of steroids, and get swallowed. Just a little bit of steroids. Not a lot of steroids. Just a little bit of steroids.
Just a little bit.
And lift some weights and come right back. Boom, Heath Slater, WWE champion. That's all he needs.
That's all he needs to do.
He's a third away there. So we got Eric Young. He never got the shot, man, that he actually deserved, man. Eric Young, like – they put him in sanity, broke him up, did whatever they had to do, man. So that's terrible.
Yeah, each person you list off, I want to know if you can hear this. Each person that you list off, I have to play this.
All right.
How the hell you gonna get fired on your day off?
So each person you list off.
Oh man! All right. Well, let's go back. We got Eric Young.
How the hell are you gonna get fired on your day off?
We got Eric Rowan.
How the hell are you gonna get fired on your day off?
We got Sarah Logan.
How the hell are you gonna get fired on your day off?
We got No Way Jose.
Hell, you gonna get fired on your day off.
We got referee Mike Chioda.
Hell,
how the hell you gonna get fired on your day off?
We got Mike Kanellis, aka Mike Bennett.
How the hell you gonna get fired on your day off?
Wait, we shouldn't be making fun of this because it's messed up, man. I'm sorry. We shouldn't be doing it. It ain't right, man. I'm sorry. I couldn't resist it.
You mean it ain't right like firing a bunch of people the day after you get considered to be an essential business?
That's true. That's true.
To make light of the people that got fired, right. But come on.
You're right.
We ain't the ones in the wrong here now. I'm just saying. So basically what happened was they Vince McMahon emailed out a video of him talking, basically addressing the employee, not the employees because they're all independent contractors, but addressing everybody in WWE. And basically he was saying, hey, you know, because of the Rona, we're going to have to like cut staff, like all the corporate employees got pay cuts, cut back on things, cut back on production expenses. But he was just like, hey, so all the rest of y'all need to sit by y'all phone because if you are getting fired, you will be receiving a phone call.
Getting that phone call.
Bruh.
I mean, he has his business reasons for it, but and I don't agree with it. And that's kind of one of the things I wanted to get into the news about with my particular story. Let me see.
Yeah.
So this man does all this firing of all these layoffs. And from article I'm reading from Forbes.com.
Yep.
And I quote.
Not WrestleWar.com.
No, Forbes.
Forbes, nigga.
WWE criticized for cutting hundreds of staff despite having over $500 million in cash reserves. Wait a minute.
Right.
Are you serious?
Right.
Are you serious, bro? So a Wednesday came and went when many WWE superstars given the same reality check that has plagued millions of recent unemployed Americans and hundreds of millions worldwide amid the spread of the novel coronavirus.
as of this writing, 22 wrestlers, 10 producers, 3 coaches, 2 announcers, a referee, a member of the creative team, and 2 on-air talents were publicly released or forego. And this is just the short list. As a significant portion of WWE's mid-card bid, I do, with 9 wrestling executives set to take a pay cut, WWE Insider at WrestleVotes posted a foreboding tweet indicating when all is said and done, the number of released talent will be well into the hundreds.
That's crazy. That's insane.
It's insane. But mind you, so you just – Here's why all of this has happened. And I recommend all of you to go out and read this article. The reason this shit happened, because he tried to make it different, WWE still had stock in the XFL. And yep. XFL going bankrupt is causing all of this. It is, bro. It sucks because the XFL, to me, was being successful. I thought it was a success. But they filed Chapter 11. So now that money... And not only it was a perfect storm. It really was. Not only did that this coronavirus stop that, it stopped WrestleMania, which is God knows how much income revenue that WWE / Mr. McMahon / Alpha Entertainment, all of that is one person. How much income he gets from that, you know? So, you know, I know he pulled out $100 million to start the XFL. I know he did that. Yep. That short circuited, and now your biggest event. That your biggest paid event that you get that pays out everything that gets canceled too.
Yep.
I mean, it sucks, man. I mean, and it's not his fault because again, like I said, the XFL had 2 years to get ready. Like it just wasn't like, okay, I'm waking up in the morning ready to start a football league. This motherfucker actually planned for the shit. And he planned like
it was doing well.
You had TV deals for 3 years. You had cities on board with their, events and entertainment business. The entertainment organization was on board. I know St. Louis were a city that had what's it called? Explore St. Louis. They were on board. And that's the funny thing. St. Louis is the largest creditor from the XFL. I think they're owed $1.6 million. I don't know. We taking kind of a detour off of this, but how do you feel about that? Like, our city wants $1.6 million of what's being owed, but they didn't even get through half the league. Do you agree with that, or is that showing just another power-hungry city? Like, not power-hungry, but money-hungry that our city is.
Well, no, I think what happened is, like, I think that because, like, the fact that City of St. Louis or any other city is a creditor is basically saying, like, this is the money that was already owed by contract. You know what I'm saying? Basically saying, like, if the league had progressed, they would have had no problem paying that money back. But what XFL was doing different than what the NFL does is that XFL was actually renting out arenas and actually paying the city, you know, like the city convention, you know, whatever, specifically for St. Louis. They were paying, like, our convention group basically to rent the stadium and, like, other subsidies so the city can employ people. You know, stuff like that. So all of that combined led to XFL having to file for bankruptcy because that's the thing. Like, since they signed a contract that said for this year we're gonna pay you this money. So what I'm assuming, and this actually happened to a lot of indie organizations for WrestleMania, is that they were in contract with arenas and hotels. It's actually helping the WrestleCon. Where they were in contract with them to basically say, hey, we're going to have the event on this day. We have this assurance, this, that, and the third. The problem is, and this goes back, I mean, this is almost conspiracy, brother, but it goes back to insurance companies, right?
Right.
It goes all the way up to insurance companies because what WrestleCon ran into was that their insurance company they didn't consider a pandemic as part of their disaster insurance.
What?
Bruh. They didn't consider that. They were basically like, disaster insurance is for if you have an earthquake, tornado, monsoon, typhoon, you know, just something like that. Whatever, like a bomb drop on it. Like, that's disaster. The act of God. Okay. Right, which, how is a pandemic not an act of God? Exactly. So when it all comes down to it, we talking bad about the insurance companies, and I'm pretty sure our feed will probably mess up really, really soon after this too, because now we talk about some real shit. But no, man, I think I like I said, I don't think that it's a credit. I don't think it's a thing where the city of St. Louis is like, hey, man, you know, we're willing to forgive the loan. It's a matter of, hey, man, you know, we need that money one way or another, which them filing for bankruptcy can't in a roundabout. Like them filing for bankruptcy is like, hey, we ain't got it. But if they have insurance, that might kick in and cover it. And one of the things that might be a part of the XFL's insurance is like, hey, if we file Chapter 11, right, this insurance is a place to pay our debts.
Right.
You know
right.
what I'm saying? They, there could be. I'm not saying that there is, but there, sometimes there are those type of provisions. In
gotcha. Yeah, and see, I don't see if this was like a all or nothing thing like he did with the first WrestleMania one, where he pretty much put all his whole savings and everything, and if it was a bust, he was done, and if it did good, or maybe I don't know, because I think he's in a position where he didn't have to do that anymore, you know, but again, this pandemic killed two of his cash gooses, like just like that, like they're gone, you know, so. It sucks, but at the end of the day, back to the question at hand, this dude had $500 million in revenues, and you. I mean, I guess it's the way of the business, man. It sucks. It sucks. I don't agree with the shit.
Well, I definitely don't agree either. But I think from Vince McMahon's standpoint, I think that everything that we were seeing as far as the XFL coming about and stuff like that, I think Vince was honestly planning his exit from wrestling.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And I think that's why he took out the 100 mil to start the XFL, basically wanted that to be its own independently running thing. He fired the top executives that were pushing the network and getting the network going as they had. He wanted to sell the rights to WrestleMania to like ESPN or
right.
they actually did sell it on pay-per-view and like Fox Sports. Like whatever Fox Sports platform is, where you pay $60 on there, which is dumb. I'm not paying $60 for no pay-per-view no more. Are you kidding me? Are you serious? I mean, right. I love AEW. I'm not paying $60 for no pay-per-view no more. I'm just saying, man, $9.99. If it ain't more than $9.99, if it's more than $9.99, I ain't paying that. That's another story. But I think I honestly think that that's what happened. Like Vince was on his way out. He was shuffling his money around, and when this pandemic hit, and he realized, oh man, I ain't gonna make this money. And this is the kicker too. When he realized that he fired the two people that got the network set up to where it needed to be, and what would be something that everybody would be watching in a pandemic right now, WWE Network. He fired the two people that set that up and put it in a good spot. So now he's probably got a little boo-boo face. He got a little egg on his face. He's like, damn, you know what? I got to keep all this bread. Because think about that for a second. Everybody watched Netflix. There was like billions of people watched Tiger King, right?
Right, right.
Think about how many people they could advertise to and just be like, yo, man, you can sit in the crib and watch old Stone Cold Steve Austin matches. And like, we got everything on it. The Barrio, George Barrios, and the other lady that was at the head of that, they would have been able to set that up. He was like, nah, man, I'm trying to get out. I'm trying to make bad decisions so the stock price goes. Somebody else can buy me out, Disney.
Right.
Now all that's off the table.
Yep.
Now Vince has to, you know, try to get his money. He might still be planning his exit, and that's rid of about 30 wrestlers might be part of that.
That's true.
So there's been more releases. In WWE.
Damn, or really?
It's actually coming out that more people have been released. So,
So
Cain Velasquez.
Okay.
Gone.
Okay. Gone. All right.
Gone out of WWE. So,
right.
This is coming from Dave Meltzer, the great Dave Meltzer of the world of wrestling.
Okay.
I think he just kind of, I guess he heard about it. He didn't have much more to say other than Cain originally was hired because WWE wanted a celebrity for Saudi Arabia. Check that off.
Right.
And Cain was originally scheduled to be in the Royal Rumble, but once that got scrapped, they had no other plans for him.
Okay.
So Meltzer didn't see AEW as a strong possibility, but could see him in AAA.
Okay.
If you follow Cain Velasquez, one of the great tragedies of them bringing in Cain Velasquez in his WWE run is nobody showing Vince the tape of him in AAA. Cain Velasquez can actually wrestle.
I heard that from Conan on his podcast, and he said that he was one of the about as a fast learner as about Kurt Angle. He compared him to Kurt Angle.
Yeah,
that's a hell of a person
when you're trying to get in. Yeah.
Absolutely. And we're not talking about just any wrestling. We're talking about Lucha Libre. Like,
right.
this motherfucker in his first match was out here doing flips and, like, jumping around the ropes, planchas, tope suicide. He's doing all that in his first match.
That's crazy.
And then what WWE do? He came in and he just, like,
He did the job to Brock.
me.
Right.
Me. I beat up Brock Lesnar in real life.
In real life.
I can actually wrestle.
Right.
And then you let me do neither one of those things.
And then you let me go. you paid me. So they literally just wasted money on this dude. He do nothing. But y'all firing people who's been there for years.
For years.
And gave y'all their heart and soul. And you let them go, but Cain Velasquez. That's funny. Cain Velasquez was the last out of that group to let go. Like, who for? Oh, no. I feel like somebody was like, y'all know we still got Cain Velasquez on the books. Like, we ain't doing it all for real? Or we get rid of him? What? What? who forgot? Y'all forgot he was on the payroll? Who's their damn accountant?
Well, I believe it. I was listening. So, if you can believe it, there is a podcast called WrestleNomics.
Okay.
The economics of WWE and pro wrestling. I was like, oh shit, this is like kind of the nerdy economy shit and the wrestling shit all put together.
Right.
But one of the things they were talking about with everybody getting laid off and stuff, or laid off and furloughed and all that, was that at a certain point, WWE had 300 wrestlers on the payroll. 300. And we talk about within the past 5 years.
This is NXT, everything.
This including everything.
So okay.
There is a good chance that there are some people that are still hired that they literally forgot about. Like, I'm like surprised. Like, the only reason they fired Zack Ryder probably is because he'd be out here. He had a whole campaign talking about how he was still there. If he hadn't been saying nothing and he was just chilling,
he probably would have been fired. Wouldn't it be funny if there was somebody that was actually signed with AEW that was still on WWE's payroll and they didn't even know it? I ain't saying shit. They don't say it. I ain't saying nothing.
Just be like, who the hell is Michael Nakazawa? Like, yeah, you're right. Who is Michael Nakazawa?
He's on TNT. What?
He was on TNT wrestling in a match with Kenny Omega, oiling himself up in the middle of the match. Right.
And you still paying him.
But speaking of people that Vince is probably still paying, or maybe not, Gerald Briscoe. It came out earlier this week that Gerald Briscoe was let go. Now,
okay.
Gerald Briscoe has since cleared it up. He came out, tweeted about it, and said that he was actually furloughed.
Okay.
So he wasn't let go. He was just furloughed for the time being, but he can come back.
Okay.
But that lets you know, man, anybody can get it. We talk about Gerald Briscoe. Yeah. He's been in the company since, I think, like the early 80s.
Right.
As a wrestler, as an agent, as this right-hand man, all that.
Right.
It's like, yo.
Yeah. He's been there for hellas.
He's been there for hellas. And it's like, yo, anybody can get it at this point, man.
Right. All right. This is gonna seem really mean and down and messed up. I'm not even gonna say it.
Oh no.
Because it's wrong. I'm not gonna say it.
I feel like this is treading on that Chris Benoit territory.
It's like right there. It's like right there. It's really, and it's kind of in context with somebody that died and wonder if the company is happy that they didn't have to do paperwork. See what I'm saying?
Oh no, we're just gonna pull that one right back. Pull that one right back.
Be funny, Marty Bell said.
She stopped smiling. She looked dead at you like. Okay, that's the goal. That's the goal for next time we record the show. You gotta have a picture of her with different expressions. And then flip out whenever you say something wrong.
I'm gonna do that. I will do that. Yes. This is an ongoing thing that we come for you, Cass. Yes.
Oh, man. As long as we in quarantine, man.
Yes.
Marty Bell background.
This shit is funny. I was laughing here for 10 minutes.
No, we go. You gonna get this Marty Bell background until she come on the show. When she come on the show, then we gonna have a background. We'll just have. She'll be one more tile,
right?
On the Brady Bunch. On the Brady Bunch layout. That she'll
and she'll be right there.
Speaking of, she'll be right there.
Uh-oh.
Well, kind of. I mean, so I sent this out earlier, but people might not be aware, but The Rock and Issa Rae, Issa Rae of Awkward Black Girl and Insecure fame for all the black, well, it's black. We on the SOLC network, Black Folks.
Right.
So The Rock and Issa Rae are executive producing and creating a show about backyard wrestling.
That is correct. It will be on HBO.
HBO. So it's probably gonna be a little bit
risque. Anything could happen here.
So Dwayne Johnson, Danny Garcia, and Issa Rae, Danny Garcia, The Rock's ex-wife, are set to executive produce a half-hour series in development with HBO about the creation of a backyard wrestling promotion Variety has learned exclusively. The project currently titled Trey Count and hails from writer Muhammad L. Masri.
Okay.
The series focuses on Cassius Jones, a young dock worker and struggling pro wrestler who uses inherited life insurance money for a startup cash and a shotgun house from his grandfather to start up a hip-hop-centric backyard wrestling empire in Houston's Third Ward, the Trey, with the help of his working-class family, neighbors and friends.
Okay.
I ain't gonna lie to you.
That sound like it might snap.
That sound dope as hell. Bro.
It kind of do. I'm not even gonna lie.
Like when I first, I think Oates sent it to me. Matter of fact, shout out. But when I first saw that, I was like, The Rock and Issa Rae, man. What?
Right.
But reading the synopsis, I waited until just now to actually read the synopsis of it, but. Yeah, man, that's all kind of dope. Man,
I think it'll be a good show. I always wanted like a mature like wrestling show on HBO. As much as all the series they have, and you know, Rock got that rapport with HBO with Ballers, and I mean, just him being a actor now and get $7 promotions really rolling right now. I mean, hey, I'm all for it.
I mean, Ballers was a dope ass show.
Ballers was dope. Yeah, for sure. Yep.
Yeah, I'm actually looking forward to it. Now, I will say this. The one thing that I don't want to happen. Now, we might lose some people here. This might be controversial.
However, I love controversy.
Controversy creates cash, in the words of Eric Bischoff.
Eric Bischoff.
Listen, don't let Issa Rae nowhere near the script. As far as dialogue is concerned.
Okay.
Now, I know the people love Insecure, right?
Right. People love that show,
bro.
Yep.
It ain't nothing against Issa Rae.
Right.
She's very talented. However,
right.
The way that people talk on that show.
Yeah.
Every time I watch it, I've only watched like one or two episodes, but I was just who are these niggas, man?
Right.
Who talks like this?
Right. Don't nobody talk like that, bro.
Don't nobody talk like that. So
nobody.
So, again. Please keep her away from the dollar. Because I don't want it to be like, ooh, girl, take this out. I got to take these bumps right quick. K-fabe, girl. K-fabe.
Oh, my God. Like, it feels like when you're like, watching, like, a story on Instagram or something like that or a Snapchat, like, that's the dialogue. That would be on her show.
Yeah, exactly. You're like you almost worked yourself into a shoot, Zaddy. No, hey man, hey, stay away from the script, please.
Hashtag taking bumps, girl. Nah, don't do that. Don't do that, bro. I don't want to see that shit.
Hashtag Team Lawrence. No. I don't want to see nobody working at Best Buy in this show. I don't want to see no SoundCloud rappers on this show.
Nothing.
I don't want to see none of that.
None of that shit. Let's not do that. Let's keep it. Let The Rock use his expertise and his experience to get this show off the road. Do not niggify this show. Please don't niggify it. We don't need to be niggified no more. Okay, what it is, okay?
I mean, they gotta be niggified a little bit, though.
But we got enough niggification in the world right now. We don't need no more. We don't need no more. No more niggification.
No more niggification 2021, because that's the next time we get out the house. Right. 2020 is done for.
If it wasn't for this damn background, we would have no more niggification as the name of the show today.
But we're going to have to table that and keep that in our pocket. No niggification is an amazing title for something. I might I might have to name a mixtape No Niggification. No niggification. That is an amazing title. We can go with that.
It is. I just thought of it like right now.
I'm gonna have you mix it.
That'll work.
You mix my DJ Rated R.
That's cool.
No niggification. No niggification mixtape.
No niggification. No more niggification.
That's right up there with. I was listening to the Scenario podcast with they had Vandalism on there. Shout out to Van breaking down the Babyface Teddy Riley joint.
Okay.
And Matt mentioned that Daryl should write a book called The Menacing Blackness. Yo, no niggification and the medicine blackness should be a volume of art.
Yes, yes, definitely. Yes, yes, they should lead in somehow. Like you know how, like, the Terminator and the Matrix, they have stories of the same. They should come, like, they should, like that.
And guess what? They both written by black people, just black, like Terminator and Matrix. Right.
Sorry, you people who didn't know that The Matrix and The Terminator was made by a black person.
Mm-hmm. A black woman.
One more for the good guys. Or what New Jack would say, I'm not going to say
No. We're gonna take it from the one more for the good guys. And on that note of one more for the good guys, this past week on SmackDown, they actually had a celebration for one of the members of the clique,
okay,
Triple H, celebrating 25 years in WWE.
25 years. Hold up. Time out. This segment was the ultimate burial of Triple H.
It was. I just watched it, and it was hilarious.
Where's the shovel?
Well, I feel like they had to give him that because for so long people have associated Triple H with burying other people. So and he had to get the smoke. Like, that's just what it was. He just had to have it.
If there was, he got all the smoke. All the smoke. they cut the lights off on this dude. I think he's got to be the only person in the state of niggerdom that has had their show cut off with the lights cut off on an episode of on Fox. I think he's got to be the only person.
Damn. Wow. And you weave all that together. The state of niggification, Fox, and getting your show cut off. Wow. That's a lot. That's a whole lot. Yeah, damn, Shawn Triple Michaels H. Run out. Yeah, I was like, damn, Triple H.
Hey, the phone calls, that was the funniest shit.
That
shit was hilarious.
That was hilarious. Stephanie called, and he was like, oh, no, Shaw wasn't talking about you. She's like, I'm watching it.
I'm seeing it. I died right there.
I'm watching it live on Fox right now.
I see it. You mean you ain't saying that? He's right there.
And then, I mean, for me, the icing on the cake was Vince bringing his senile ass out there and just talking about shit that wasn't even Triple H's fault. Like,
right.
Vince started talking about the gobbledygooker and I'm like, wait a minute, he wasn't even around. That was more than 25 years ago, Vince.
I felt like he was high. I felt like he was high.
Man,
he was high.
you think Vince be on that ganja now? Wait, time out. Okay, here's a question. Vince is high. What kind of drugs does Vince McMahon do?
I think he's on ganja. I think he's smoking the ganja, for real. Seriously. I don't see Vince as like a hardcore like cocaine person. Like I literally see him smoking weed. Like for real.
Not anymore. He might have been a hardcore coach, like in the 80s.
Like, yeah, when it was the hype of the, yeah, he was probably on some shit. Yeah.
This was definitely on coke when they was at that strip club. He let the Road Warriors give him a doomsday device in the strip club. He was on coke that day, hands down. And now, if you haven't heard that story, I'm pretty sure it's on YouTube or whatever, but Vince used to kick it with the boys back in the day.
Yeah.
They were all at the strip club, and he legit let Legion of Doom do his move where Animal pick him up on his shoulders and Hawk.
The Doomsday device?
The Doomsday device, yeah. And Hawk jumped off the strip club stage and clotheslined him and flipped him over. And
in the strip club. Cocaine's a hell of a drug. Not that I know. I don't know any. I'm just saying that's a quote from Rick James. I'm just saying what he said.
Rick James said some very, very real things. And that's probably the realest thing he's ever said.
Yeah, he was dead serious when he said this shit.
So, I'm going to put you on the spot a little bit. But on the subject of Triple H, man,
all right.
What is your favorite Triple H match?
My favorite Triple H match would be him versus Shawn Michaels when Shawn Michaels returned at SummerSlam.
Ooh.
And it was the unsanctioned match. That's one of that. Not only is that one of my favorite Triple H matches, that's one of my favorite matches of all time. I just far as the storytelling. I mean, there was storytelling from the actual the story itself, and then the psychology in the ring with Shawn Michaels selling the back injury. I mean, we all know Shawn Michaels is one of the best showmen in all of pro wrestling. But the way they played that way out, and it was a story from the start of the segment to the very end with Triple H. Like, do yourself a favor and go on the WWE Network and look at that match. I don't remember what year it was. Was it 06 or 04? I don't know.
It had to be
05 or something like that. It's a SummerSlam with Triple H versus Shawn Michaels in a unsanctioned match. Do yourself a favor and watch that match. Like, if you like that Undertaker Shawn Michaels match at the WrestleMania, you'll love. Like, this is just as good as that. Seriously, the storytelling. They used every element of wrestling you could think of. It's a just phenomenal match. Phenomenal match.
And once you see it, like, you won't miss it because Shawn Michaels is wearing Wranglers.
Yeah, he was.
It also speaks to the genius of Shawn Michaels being able to put on a 5-star match in Wranglers and cowboy
boots. Right, and cowboy boots. And Triple H is in full gimmick. And this fool, like, Triple H in full gimmick, he come out. It looked like Shawn literally just came from the mall or some shit. Or he just came from the crib. He was like, all right, I'm going to go ahead and do this match real quick.
He said, hey, I'll be right back.
Right.
So I'm gonna go with the early 2000s Triple H match. My favorite Triple H match is Triple H versus Chris Jericho, Last Man Standing, from Fully Loaded 2000. So that was the first time that they had done a Last Man Standing match in like 18 years in WWF.
Okay.
And Chris Jericho, Triple H had that really, really hot feud at the time. They had the false finish of Jericho winning the championship around that time.
Right.
But that was the Last Man Standing match when the finish of it was Triple H suplexed Chris Jericho through the announce table.
Right. And
Triple H stood up at 7 and fell back down after 10 and won the match. That was dopest Triple H match to me.
Okay, all right. So now I'm gonna reverse. I'm putting you back on the spot. All right. And I'm responding to a tweet that I saw, and literally, like, you remember when Triple H and Undertaker did that promo without saying anything? Well, someone put a tweet. Someone put a tweet out, and it pretty much was just it had the same effect as that, but they said it was saying something else. They had a tweet of Triple H, and right next to him was Paul Pierce. Do you think that's true? Do you think that's like that's saying a lot without saying anything? Do you agree with that at all, or
I'm gonna have to say yeah, man. Like, I'm just going. You know what? I'm just gonna fuck it.
Because Paul Pierce proclaims he's like the best four that's ever played the game.
Like, no. That was the one where Triple H put the thumbs down, right? Right.
But I looked at that tweet and it literally had no words with it. And I was like, oh no. And I'm like, damn. Like in a whole scale, I'm not knocking what this man's doing phenomenal shit now with the start of NXT and his career. I mean, just phenomenal. I don't think it's per se his ability of what we've saw on TV or what has been portrayed, because he's great. I think it's more of the lines of there's a lot of stars that are in that mix with him that are just maybe just a tier higher. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, it was the same thing with Paul Pierce, man. It's just like when you're in a loaded league.
Right.
It's kind of easy. I mean, it's one thing to be great, but then it's one thing to be great in that era.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Right. And like Triple H was in the Stone Cold. He was in the Shawn Michaels. He was in the Rock.
Undertaker.
He was even in the Bret Hart. Like at the
tail end. Right.
Like I think Matt might have said this one time where it's like, you know, Triple H got his shine because he was due to like, you know, the hold the championship. He was the heel. He was he wasn't really putting the other folks over.
Right.
He did kind of fall into that time of like Rock leaving and Austin leaving, and I mean shit, he was around with Cena. I mean,
right. You know, like, that too.
Even Cena passed him up. So it's just like, you know, I think here's the thing, man. You know, we talk about this a lot. And, you know, him marrying the boss's daughter, as calculated as that is, it wasn't just calculated on the level of marrying the boss's daughter. It was also for his legacy.
Sure.
So you don't get an NXT if Triple H doesn't carry into the main family.
No.
So ultimately, I think what his legacy ultimately will be is the guy running WWE. And he knew that. He knew that going in, where it was just like, yo, I could be a top guy and I can from experience, you know, show that I know what I'm doing.
Right.
Parlay that into
being and there's no doubt about it that he definitely knows what he's doing. There's nothing. I mean, this man has literally been in like two of the best factions all time, Evolution and DX. I mean,
exactly.
It's just when I think of like if you talk about name me top five, he won't be in there. It's because there's other people who he was in that mix with that, to me, in my opinion, were just better. I'm not saying he not, because he's still like he. If it was top five, he may be six. You know what I'm saying? Like it ain't like So, and there's no disrespect. Like I know he's great. He's great. It's Triple H, man. You know, it's just it's. But it just when I saw that Paul Pierce thing, it just made me think like, damn, is he really kind of like that? I don't know.
that's a hell of a comparison, right there.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of. Athletes, I guess. So, Rob Gronkowski, aka Gronk, is returning to the NFL.
Yes, he is.
Returning to the NFL to go play in Tampa Bay with his homeboy Tom Brady.
Tom Brady, yeah.
Here's the wrinkle.
Uh-oh.
He is still the reigning, defending, longest reigning, 24/7 champion.
So, I read a tweet that and WWE is funny for this shit. Yeah, kayfabe, right? They said he must fulfill his 24/7 obligations at all times. So you mean to tell me a motherfucker gonna come out there when it's third and four and roll it?
Oh, dude, that's gonna be hilarious. It's gonna be hilarious the first time he get back on the field and somebody tackle him and just sit there
and pin him and then bring a referee out.
I would, you know what? I'd give the NFL some points back if one of the referees on the, like one of the NFL refs actually make the count. Like, it's a referee.
That would be epic. That would be epic.
I'd give the NFL some points back. Not a whole lot, but I'd give them some points back.
Not a whole lot. I'll give them some points back too if they go ahead and pay for the XFL too and use it as their developmental league. I'll give them some points for that too. Because then the St. Louis team is still alive. Damn it.
That'd be dope. Which reminds me, I need to give me some Battle Hawks gear before it all sells out and just disappears. Never available again. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, we're just gonna move on to some some more on brand news with the week coming for UCast.
Okay.
So Jerry Lawler's in the news.
What do you do, man?
Quite frankly, Jerry Lawler might circle back once we get back to once we talk about the award, but we'll circle back to that. But
yeah, this is true.
So Jerry Lawler, it was a commentator on Raw. He had to address a comment that he made.
Oh, yeah, I heard about that. Yeah, so, he fucked up.
But ironically enough, it wasn't award-worthy yet this week. Somebody did something
more. No. It's definitely not award, dog. This dude, the dude who getting the award, it takes the cake. He's getting that motherfucker. He's getting the award.
On the latest edition of Jerry Lawler's podcast, Jerry Lawler addressed his recent comment while doing a commentary on Raw. On the April 13th edition of the show, Lawler was calling an Akira Tozawa Austin Theory match with Tom Phillips and Byron Saxton. When he referred to a Tozawa senton as a ramen noodle moonsault.
You can't say that, Jerry. You can't say that in 2020, man. You cannot say that. And we're laughing. It's fucked up. You can't say that.
That's like a
Roman Newton dog. For real? So, it's for real.
That's like on South Park where the commentators were commentating the football game and the woman says some fucked up shit and the other was like, dude, not cool. Not cool.
You can't say that, bro. You can't.
But here's the problem. So, Jerry Lawler doubled down on it.
Oh, my God.
He basically blamed it on the fact that he doesn't have chemistry with Tom Phillips and Byron Saxton yet. So, he was talking about commentating in 2016 with Mauro Ranallo. And he said, I would say something like, there's the ramen noodle moonsault. And he would go, oh, King, you know there's no such thing. And we would just go on. I was doing it to play devil's advocate with Mauro. If I were still doing commentary with Michael Cole or JR, we had the chemistry to where each one of those guys would have known that I was almost making a fool of myself by claiming like I was acting like I knew what this unbelievable looking move was. Then either Cole or JR would have said, oh, King, you know much better than that. With Byron and Tom, we don't have that chemistry yet. We only have been working together for a short time. So when I say that, they didn't even acknowledge it. So
you can't say that in 2020, bro. You can't do it point blank, period. That's like saying if Apollo Crews does a move and you call it the fried chicken and suplex, you can't say that shit.
or it's like saying that somebody, Trevor Murdoch, can ride around Ethiopia with a bucket of chicken tied to his back and fend for himself, Jim Cornette.
Can't say that, Jim Cornette. That's why you got let go from NWA. You can't say that, bro.
Yeah, Jim Cornette.
That's fucked up. New Jack said it. He just said he's cool. He's cool. He's good business about it. This is a hint of racism. Yeah, we know that now. That's a dash. Just a pinch of racism. You know, just a little bit.
when Jim Cornette be cooking up his shit, he'd be like, okay, here the salt, here the pepper, here the garlic powder, onion. Reach around there and hand me that razor. just reach around there and hand me that
razor. not a whole lot. Can't have too much. Can't put too much in there. It won't taste right. It's a little bit. You just got a little bit of flavor in there. It's just a little bit.
It won't taste right.
You put too much of that shit in there, it's going to get fucked up. Well.
So on that note, how much racism was in Jerry Lawler's ramen noodles?
So what his ass did, instead of using the chicken or the beef pack, he got his own goddamn pack and put it in there. It was too much.
That's what Jerry Lawler get for trying to season his own damn ramen noodle.
You ain't supposed to use what they give you. Don't put your own shit in there. That's why it's in there, Jerry.
That's why it's rationed in a pack.
Right.
You rip it open, pour it
in there. That's it. Don't be trying to put no extra shit in there if you ain't going to do it right, which is what your ass didn't do.
Yeah. And now
right.
Look at you.
Ain't that right?
Now look at you. You done messed up your ramen noodles with too much racism.
Oh, man.
Well, we're gonna try to counter that racism. So you know how you add too much salt, you gotta add something else to counteract the salt. So that's what we're going to do right now. So we're going to talk about Asia Smith. So She's was an independent pro wrestler. Now she's a referee with WWE.
Right.
But on Raw this past Monday, she became the first black female referee to officiate a match on Raw.
Wow. And she got to be she has to be the first black referee, women referee in WWE, if I recall. Okay.
Yeah.
Period. Unless you consider when Jazz was a special guest referee, a referee. we talking about like not a guest special, a referee on you. Your W-2 say what your job description, it says referee. That's what you do.
Hey, referees get W-2s and it's a referee.
I wondered that. Like, I know this is kind of off the top. The independent contractors is the wrestlers. Yep. But do the referees and the commentators, are all of them salary, or are they 1099?
I think they're 1099 as well.
Okay.
Actually. Yeah,
okay.
I think unless you have an office job, you have an office job in addition, it's kind of like the Triple H thing. Or if we switch over to AEW, it's kind of like with Kenny Omega, Cody Rhodes, Young Bucks, Christopher Daniels. Like they all have like actual office jobs in addition to talent.
Right.
So. If you own TV, you got 1099.
Okay.
But does your 1099 still say referee?
Right. Or does it say independent contractor and it's got that bullshit little bitty ass writing on there and say you can't go nowhere for 6 months after that you go up your so if you're a referee and your ass get hurt, do they extend your contract 6 months?
No, they like record storylines and you trying to kill yourself. Like, they did Tim White when he got hurt in the Hell in a Cell match.
Them WWE contracts, boy. I would love to just like get a copy of one and just dissect the shit out of it. We should look for one online on like Reddit or something. I'm pretty sure there's got to be one out there.
Yeah, we got to get people familiar with the SOLC network. We got to get Brandon, aka B Dub. We got to get Dub to look over a WWE contract. Yeah. And just we could probably go a full 2 hours of him being like, man, nigga, this shit is bullshit.
Bullshit. We should call it "This is bullshit" segment. This is bullshit.
Hey man, why would you ever sign anything like this? This is terrible.
Damn. We just coming up with new segments all day long. Damn, we gonna have a fucking 4 hour long podcast once all said and done.
We just gonna have to start going every day of the week.
And so, right.
Like, just Monday.
Different segment.
You're about to bust it open radio.
Right.
Well, speaking of new segments.
When you think of pro wrestling, you think of three things. You think of tradition.
Hi, everybody, and welcome once again to Wrestling at the Chase.
To Dick the Bruiser, Harley Race, Pat O'Connor, God rest his. I wrestled every great star in this business, in this building. And I can honestly say it was my greatest honor in my career to participate in the great city of St. Louis in the Kiel Auditorium on Friday nights. Bottom line.
You think of history.
Here in St. Louis, the winner and new
you think of downright shock value.
That's gotta be Cain! That's gotta be Cain! Oh my God! It's Sting! What? Stinger's here!
Now there's only one place that I can think of that embodies all three of those. Tell them where it is, Scotty.
As I stand here in the show me state of St. Louis, Missouri!
It's a city.
Welcome to the STL segment. Because you can't spell wrestling without STL.
You can find me in St. Louis.
Hey, that's dope.
Everybody, welcome to the STL segment. Apologize for the long intro. I had to do that. I got to get my city justice, man. The reason this new segment actually came about, we actually, when we were on the Scenario podcast, I actually brought up a little small segment talking about the history in pro wrestling in St. Louis, Missouri. As you all know, there's been numerous history in our great city. And we are going to be a podcast that's going to highlight a certain historic moment in professional wrestling. That's what's going to be it. The STL segment. Because, again, you can't spell wrestling without STL.
Ooh, so you cannot. Let's go. Yes.
So let's get it started. We can probably do it a little basic here. I don't want to get too in-depth. And I'm going to try to pull something out that some of y'all might not even remember. Let me get the year when this happened. I'm sorry. I should have had this ready. I was too busy making the intro before the podcast. Let's see here. I'm going to do a Wikipedia. Let me see. So the first STL segment I would like to bring up is the first ever TNA pay-per-view in St. Louis called Lockdown.
Yeah.
RVS. One of my favorites. We were definitely in attendance for this pay-per-view. This is all from Wikipedia.com, and it quotes, Lockdown in 2007 was a professional wrestling pay-per-view event produced by TNA, which took place April 15, 2007, coming from the Family Arena in St. Charles, Missouri, which is a suburb not far from St. Louis, if you don't know where we're at.
Yes, sir.
This was the second monthly pay-per-view after Bound for Glory, which was 2006, to be held outside of Orlando. It was the third annual event of the Lockdown chronologically. Eight professional wrestling matches were featured on this event's card. Of those matches here, I have them listed here. Voodoo Ken Mafia, which is Road Dogg and Kip James, Road Dogg and Billy Gunn, with Lance Hoyt defeated Serotonin, which was Kaz and Havoc, with Christy Hemme. And that was in the set. So here's the thing with this pay-per-view. Every match was inside the cell, was inside the cage. Every single match.
Every single one.
Yep. So they won their match.
Side note, Lance Hoyt, who now goes by Lance Archer.
Okay.
AEW killing it right now. The Murder Hawk Lance Archer.
Okay.
Actually killing it right now. So we saw him early on in his career.
Yep. All right. So match number two. You had Chris Sabin. He defeated Jay Lethal. Jay Lethal had the big homie, Kevin Nash.
Yes, sir. On his side.
Sanjay Dutt.
Ain't that crazy?
That's crazy, bro.
That's
shit crazy. He was there. We didn't even know it.
Right.
Sanjay Dutt, Alex Shelley, and Shark Boy. The match ended with an escape for the TNA X Division Championship. So Chris Sabin won that match. Robert Roode with Miss Brooks and Eric Young defeated Petey Williams. Gail Canadian Kim.
Destroyer.
Yep, Gail Kim.
Canadian Destroyer is a finish, by the way.
Yes, it is. Yes, it's not a regular ass move like y'all make it out to be. Like, that's the – time for another – see, I've been on the sales segment, side on to the segment. It's time for another one of these
Rated R. I can't play the video right now. you motherfuckers, quit doing all these damn finishing moves as regular ass moves, man. Could y'all please stop doing that? Yeah, please stop doing that, bro. Bradshaw was able to make his whole career having a regular ass move as a finishing move as a clothesline, but now y'all taking the big spots moves and they regular ass moves. Like you do a corkscrew DDT off the top rope, they kick out at two. Nigga, you dead. You ain't supposed to kick out at two. You dead. That's been another one of these rated R ass. Okay, Gail Kim defeated Jackie Moore, and that was a cage match. Since she defeated Austin Starr, the homie James Storm defeated Chris Harris, and that was a six sides of steel blindfold match.
Yeah,
Christopher. Christopher Daniels defeated Jerry Lynn. In match number eight, you had Team 3D or the Dudleys defeating the Latin American Exchange, Homicide and Hernandez. That was the electrified six sides of steel. Tell him, Ray. Go ahead.
I'm gonna say I have a very personal story about that. The electrified cage match. So the actual match itself, we were just thinking the whole time, like, how are they gonna do this match? Like, you know, nobody's gonna actually get electrocuted, but how are they gonna make this? Are they gonna have pyro in when somebody touches it? Oh man, that'd be super dope to see like what it actually is. Man.
What they do.
So the finish of the match was Homicide getting thrown into the cage and getting electrocuted. But what they did was somebody in the back was flicking the lights on and off, and they played some sound that went. And he shook like he was getting electrocuted. He actually shook like he was getting shot. Like when Scarface was getting shot at the end. He's like, I take your bullets. I take it. That's how Homicide was shaking, right? So everybody is like let down about that. So we're gonna come back to the car. But after the show, you know, we outside, we posted up where all the rest is leaving. I'm pretty sure Rated R got a story coming up.
Oh, this motherfucker. He should get the award too. Shit.
We see like Team 3D. Oh, Team 3D won their first TNA belts that night.
They sure did. Yep, they did.
They came out and we were like, yo, congratulations, blah, blah, blah. They were super cool, dapping everybody up. Well, Homicide came out. Am I ignorant ass? I was just like, hey, man, you know, appreciate it. Good match, you know, whatever. He was like, oh, yeah, thank you, man. I was like, hey, man, what the fuck was up with that electric car? He was like, man, if you don't, I was like, no, bro, no disrespect, bro, but come on. But you can tell he only got mad at me because
right.
He was already mad.
He was mad because the shit was stupid. How you gonna flick some damn ear on ear? Come on, man.
He got mad at me because there was other people around. If it had just been me and him, he probably would be like, man, that was some bullshit.
Right.
The other fans around and shit. He got mad. I'm like, right, respect, man, you know, whatever.
Oh man, and then the main event. Oh man, hell of a main event too. Team Kurt Angle, it's Kurt Angle, Samoa Joe, Rhino, Sting, and Jeff Jarrett defeated Team Cage, which was Christian Cage, AJ Styles. Listen to this roster: Christian Cage, AJ Styles, Scott Steiner, Abyss, and Tomko with James Mitchell. Lethal Lockdown match with Harley Race as the gatekeeper. Like, so you had all of that as your main event. Again, this event took place, again, St. Charles, Missouri, which is it's a suburb, maybe 20 minutes from downtown of St. Louis. This was April 15th, 2007. This was TNA Nonstop Action. Again, wrestling lives here in St. Louis. We have history, plenty of it. And like I said, you can't spell wrestling without STL.
That's what I'm talking about. New segment, can't spell wrestling without STL, man. Yep. That's dope, man.
Yep. The STL segment.
Woo, man, that was a dope ass event. Like one of the hardest TNA DVDs to find for some reason.
Right.
I don't know
right.
why. I don't know if they just didn't make like very many of them, but you know, I used to be heavy in collecting the wrestling DVDs and stuff uh-huh. like that. I have a bunch of TNA DVDs, but for whatever reason, that lockdown, I cannot find. Well, I could probably find it online.
But, sure. Man. But not a physical copy. So
yeah, not a physical
copy. So side note, RVS said I had something to talk about, which I do. Which happened at the end of this damn show. All right. So, mind you,
So here's a funny thing. So before I get to that motherfucker, we was we was just walking around the concourse just trying to get something to eat. And this was the time where TNA was just starting to, like, they was trying to be really different than what WWE was doing, you know? And, like, they would do, like, their fan interaction was at another level. Like, I don't think I've ever been to an event where their fan, like, fucking Bob Backlund was in my face and we yelled at each other for, like, 5 minutes. It was crazy. But but the main thing is you walk around a concourse and we're walking around and it was just, like this older, a Caucasian woman, and she was decent looking. And, you know, and she's walking around with two other guys. And she comes to us and asks, you know, hey, how's the show going? Like, yeah, the show's really good. We really enjoy it. She's like, are you enjoying yourself at the show? Is everything going okay? She's like, yeah, like just straight up, like, you ever had, like, great customer service if you went to, like, a retail place and, the manager comes out to check, yep. like if you go to Applebee's? This was like her. Yep. So,
chef come out.
Yeah, so... We didn't know who this was until we asked her, like, yo, so she was like, yeah, what's your name? So I'm Dixie Carter.
No, I think it was my boy Tim.
Yeah.
She walked away. He said, do y'all know who that is?
I'm like, no.
He's like, nah. He was like, that's Dixie Carter. That's the owner of TNA. We were like, wait, what?
What?
imagine if you went to a WWE show and Vince McMahon was walking around like, oh.
Right.
Having a good time. Did you like the kiss of my ass, Matt? What'd you think?
But that ain't make me forget about what happened at the end of you motherfucker you and the motherfucking Lincoln Town Car. So we're leaving. We're leaving lockdown, right? And for some reason, TNA had the damn wrestlers walk out with the damn fans. Like, they're literally, where they parked at was where the fuck we parked at. So we walking out with the Dudleys. They getting fucking ransacked by fans and shit. They trying to leave. So it gets to this moment where there's a spot where you have to cross over to get to regular parking. And I'm about to, like, walk across this damn walkway to get there. And this motherfucking beige-ass Lincoln Continental fucking going about 60, almost hits me. I'm like, damn, who the fuck was that? Now, mind you, I'm sitting here like I'll process all of this, and I looked in the windows because I see this motherfucker driving fast as hell. Like, he ain't got no goddamn sense, right? Do you know who it was that was trying to, you know, do you want to know who it is, IWC? You want to know who the fuck it was?
Who was it?
It was motherfucking Sting. Sting almost ran me over. I'm not lying, bro. It was Sting. His punk ass almost ran me over to say, I should have reported this. I should have got hit so I could have got paid. Clipped the damn... This motherfucker almost ran me over, bro.
Oh, no. He was doing about 45 out there.
Hey, man, he was rolling, bro. I ain't never seen nobody drive that damn fast before and a bunch of motherfucking people. Motherfucking Sting, you get the award because, and it ain't even a damn same. You get the award because you almost ran me over. Hey, man, you ask shenanigans, me and you going to have words. We got to talk. We can talk about it, and then we done with it. You know what I'm saying? But we got to talk. It's got to happen.
You almost ran me over in 2007. You're going to be like, what?
But that's the STL segment, y'all. New segment, we're going to highlight something that's happened in the history of professional wrestling in our great city of St. Louis. Yes, that's what we're going to do that every episode.
Yes, sir. I'm looking forward to more installments of that. But
it's time, baby.
It's Vader time. It's time for that very, 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 very illustrious award. We give out to the person that is most acting an ass and doing something stupid in the world of pro wrestling. Rated R, tell them what it's called.
Oh, boy. It is now called the John Jones Memorial Freedom Award, formerly called the You Fucked Up, You Know Your Ass Is Doomed Award. We award this person somebody. First of all, we can talk about the recruit. We recently just rechristened the You Fucked Up, You Know Your Ass Is Doomed Award to the John Jones Freedom Memorial Award, Because John Jones just ass don't want to be free. He just want to keep doing dumb shit. So we just decided just to name the award after his ass. Okay?
After his freedom.
After his freedom. Because he doesn't want his freedom. Clearly he doesn't. This man has millions. He's one of the best fighters in the world. But he just keeps doing dumb shit.
John Jones don't want his freedom. So we're going to give it away to people
to people who do dumb shit. Right. Because clearly he don't want it. So you all know who getting this goddamn award. Goddamn Patrick Clark, motherfucking Velveteen Dream. Come on, man. Hey, read it off. Read it off, Ray.
So Patrick Cloud, aka Velveteen Dream.
Motherfucker.
You award this week for allegations.
Oh my god.
That he sent explicit photos and explicit DMs to minors.
Did this motherfucker forget that he just turned 23 or whatever? Because when he was doing, it don't matter. It's still wrong. What are you doing, bro? What are you doing?
Patrick. Come on, man. What the hell wrong with you, dog? So, there had been allegations, basically not even allegations, but people put out receipts on Twitter.
Sound bites
of their DM. So allegedly, Patrick Clark had an event where he opened his DMs to fans. Let's pause there.
Stop there.
So it's extremely shady when a famous person opens their DMs to fans.
Now
are we gonna have to get on the Jesus Shuttlesworth train? You know how DMs work?
Yeah. Do we need to explain this? Because for the sake of people who don't know what we're talking about, Ray, why don't you go ahead and explain that?
So your homie Ray Allen, right? I'm pretty sure the fellas at the scenario talked about this on the network. Go back and listen to that episode. But Ray
several
Allen,
times.
Several times. Ray Allen was out here, got caught out here years ago, thinking that he was sending DMs, but he was just regularly tweeting people. And he's out here just hopping in DMs that don't exist because he on regular Twitter. He on the timeline, but he think he in the DMs because he obviously didn't know how DMs work. So Patrick Clark, Velveteen Dream. Now we gonna call him by his government. Now he don't deserve
Patrick Clark. Goddamn,
he don't deserve kayfabe right now.
Patrick Clark Jr.
is out here not knowing how DMs work.
Yeah,
and telling fans, quote unquote, hey, I am opening my DMs. Holler at me. Right? So, of course, there's going to be some shady character. Not even shady character. No. There's going to be people in there that's like, oh, I'm a kid. I like Patrick Clark.
Right.
I'm going to his DMs.
Right.
This nigga. This nigga then proceeds to talk to people. People got screenshots, they got videos and all this. And it's like, yeah, man, so what you doing in school? What you want to be when you grow up? So the sound bite that they got is him asking, what school do you go to? And it's definitely Patrick Clark's.
It's him.
So unless he cut a wrestling promo where he was asking somebody what school they went to. Which he hasn't.
That's like, okay, you don't ask no little kid. That's like asking a grown man, what's your fucking shoe size? You don't do that shit. and me and RVS have witnessed this. Asking somebody, you ask a 7 foot, 300 and something pound dude what their shoe size is. You don't do that.
Like, no, because I don't care. I don't care, okay? Because I am a grown man and I have sense. But you know who doesn't care? Patrick Clark Jr., because he in here asking kids what school they go to. But not only that, but just easing the conversation into some things that I don't even want to repeat because
it's not
terrible.
It's,
right?
It's that Chris Benoit line. Like,
yep. We trend into as you trend closer and closer to infinity. You take the derivative and you trend closer and closer to infinity.
Yeah, motherfucker, stop. It just
go in that line and just go. It just keep going. That's how we gonna do. We're not gonna touch that line. But Patrick actually sent nudes to these kids. On top of that, and if you're listening to this, Rated R just walked away and disappeared behind Marty Bell. Yeah, he's out here bad, man. He out here bad. Now, he released a statement on Friday, apparently. So he's 24. He just turned 24. Don't matter.
Fucking matter, bro.
Don't matter. But he says, and I quote, "Be assured, I did not communicate inappropriately with anyone. A private photo of mine was shared without my consent or knowledge, and I am working with a third party to look into this matter." Now, let's back up for a second.
Yeah, let's do that.
So, yes, a private photo of yours was shared without your consent.
Mm-hmm.
How did they get your photo, your photo, Patrick?
Exactly, Patrick. See, because they couldn't have just got it from your head. They couldn't have just... So we know that there's been WWE women and men, yes, have had their iClouds hacked.
Exactly.
Okay, and there's been some nudes that have been shared on over the internet.
Yep.
So hindsight 2020, okay, if I want to play devil's advocate, okay, Patrick, let's say I agree. Okay, I agree with you. Fine. Okay. You shouldn't... Why, man?
Well, here's even to that point. So, you know, other people's accounts have been hacked and they've gotten their lie, you know, they've gotten their pictures or photos or whatever put out on the internet.
But here's the thing. Yeah, but here's the thing.
Those people got their, like, they basically, the people that hacked it put it out to everyone.
Right.
Not some little kids.
A specific person. And these people that did get hacked wasn't having interactions with them. There's no paper trail. Nigga, there's a paper trail to you. You fucked up.
A paper trail.
IP address.
A MAC address.
Subnet mask. You fucked up.
And literally, you know your ass is doomed,
right?
Because you are going to jail.
Yeah, you're going to jail, bro. That your career ain't no AEW. That's it, bro. You done.
That's it.
Done, dog.
Ask Orlando Jordan, who had a very similar gimmick to Patrick Clark. Orlando Jordan got knocked for the exact same thing, and now. And if you're not Orlando, Orlando Jordan.
Yeah, that's his name. Yeah.
So he got knocked for the exact same thing. He tried to play it like he was like one of the first openly gay wrestlers.
Right.
He
tried to play
it like the industry blackballed him because he was gay. Mm-mm. When in fact, he was blackballed from the industry because he was bringing young dudes to shows with him.
He need his ass kicked flat out, bro. Like somebody need to fuck him up.
And that would happen in jail.
Yeah. If I could play the fucking soundbite right now, I would go straight to it. You know I'll go straight to scare straight right now. You know I would. you need to splice that in here somewhere.
That's the name I'll put it in. Your name, Bridget. And you better be happy. You better act like you happy to be motherfucking Bridget.
Man, come on, Patrick, man. That's, man, you fucked up, bro. You have destroyed your career, dude. There's no and normally I'm silly with these you fucked up, you know, they ass is doing the shit, but I don't have any remorse for this shit, bro.
No.
Like you shouldn't have been doing that. Flat the fuck out, bro. Like I'm literally like disappointed in your ass for doing this shit, bro.
Yeah.
Like for real. You had your whole life ahead of you. Like literally want to be the top star. You could have been something in WWE, and you fuck around and do this dumb shit. Like, you mean to tell me that you ain't get ain't enough ass out there for you to get all the women that you want to roll with? You mean to tell me you can't get no ass out there, my nigga? For real? I don't believe that shit.
Or men. I'm like, you know, if that's what he's into, you know, that's fine.
Yeah, yeah, if that's what you into, like,
but
like,
there are plenty of grown adults,
right?
Grown adult people,
right?
That you could be in D, like you could be
in
your DMs too,
right? Right. Like, but you fucking with some, nah, man, I don't have any remorse for you, dog. Like, for real. As far as I'm concerned, you deserve everything you're supposed to get, flat out. If all the stories, what it's supposed to be, is true, I know everybody's innocent to proven guilty, but nigga, this shit don't look good. And when there's smoke, there's fire.
Nope.
And goddamn it, the fire that you got, his motherfucking Scorpion from Ultimate Mortal Kombat pulled his mask off and blew that shit all over the place. Nigga, you are dead. You are fucking barbecue chicken, my nigga. You are done. You will be getting an overnight of the John Jones Freedom Memorial Award. God damn it.
Nigga, start up. You dead.
You are fucking dead. You are done, bruh. Stick a fork in it. It's nigga black. It's done. This is like a steak in a fucking barbecue that's cooked too damn long. It's done.
Done. Well done. Crackety coon.
You fucked up, bruh. Yeah, yo, fuck up is damn near borderline to change it to the Patrick Clark Freedom Memorial Award, because you damn near about to take the John Jones ain't did that crazy shit. Now John Jones just keep fucking up, just doing dumb. But
yeah. We gotta make sure it still be funny for other people. We can't have this award be depressing.
Right. You fucking running NXT. You was gonna be the man in the main roster, and look at you do some dumb. Fucking, even if you wasn't a pro wrestler, why would you fucking do this shit, man? Like, it's too many fucking women or men, if that's what you into, out there, like you said, that are grown, that is posting that type of shit on social media. Everybody's doing that shit now. Everything's on fucking social media. You can follow one of them, and you, nigga, you on TV. Motherfuckers can see you. You got more clout than what, if you chasing a man or a woman, you can fucking do the shit. But you want to chase after a fucking minor, fucking Patrick. You were supposed to have kids. How would you feel like if somebody did that to your fucking child? Exactly. You want to fucking kill them, you right. Motherfucker, you.
Shout out to Jerry Lawler.
Yeah.
Shout out to Jerry Lawler.
Yeah. Motherfucking, damn, man.
So, on that note, I'm probably...
No, go ahead. Got man. It was another rated R rant. Two-part rated R rant. Fucking Patrick. Rated R rant / John Jones Freedom Memorial Battle. I'm about to call it a Memorial Battle.
But that does bring up a good point. We might have to, like, at the end of the year, have a John Jones Freedom Memorial Battle Warrior.
Like a train wreck show? Yeah, all of them. I need to write them down.
Oh, I got them in the show notes. They're in the show notes.
Okay.
I like that idea.
So that's kind of similar to what I loved what they do on the Keeping It 100 podcast with Conan. So Disco bit off of Jericho, and he does his disco list. Yeah. And it's literally like a whole bunch of mother. I might want to run down and go through some of this shit one day. I might do the disco list on here one day. And this shit, I just want to bring it to you so you can laugh your ass off.
Oh, yeah.
Thursday, I'll write it down of everybody he has on this list. And then I'll repeat it on our podcast.
That's that. Yeah, we can make that.
Because I think they only do it once a month. So now we can do it. We can do the disco list every week on our podcast to get that motherfucker's attention. Like, you know what song black people doing your damn disco listening? Yeah.
No, and what you gotta say is that black dude that keep beating your ass in fantasy football.
right.
Because for the folks that don't know, Rated R is in the fantasy football league with the wrestler Conan.
Yep, we do.
Inferno, who else is on that show?
Their producer, JoJo producer. Shout out to JoJo. Shout out to Conan. Shout out to D.I. Tommy Dreamer is actually in this. Tommy Dreamer. Wow.
I'll explain why that's really funny at another time, later date.
Tommy Dreamer is in this fantasy football league, and I remember I beat him a couple of times for cash. He was right below me, and I won.
Nice. Oh man. I think there might.
I beat Tommy Dreamer.
In more ways than one.
What's up, Matt Stryker? Hey.
We'll come back to that one on the Patreon.
I don't even know if I want that shit out there.
You're right,
hey, because we see them niggas.
Put the thing down, flip it, and reverse it. As a matter of fact, I might just bleep that whole thing out.
Before we get out of here, we got one more segment that we got to give to y'all. It's the segment where we highlight a black wrestler, somebody that's influential to the industry. So we're recording on 4/19, and it's only right that we highlight this man before 4/20. I'm going to highlight our man, Charles Wright,
yes,
a.k.a. the Godfather, a.k.a. Papa Shango, a.k.a. Comin Mustafa.
Yes! Yes!
shout out to Matt and Daryl, the scenario. We got into a conversation about Charles on their show. This probably dropped before this one does. But I mentioned that this man actually in real life loves cannabis and loves women.
Yep.
So
that is accurate statement.
Living the gimmick, brother. Charles Wright is an American semi-retired professional wrestler. He is best known for his tenure in the World Wrestling Federation throughout the 90s and 2000s, where he performed under the ring names Sir Charles, Papa Shango, Comin Mustafa, the Godfather, and also in the Right to Censor days, the Good Father.
Oh, okay.
That was a deep cut right there.
Yeah.
Among other accolades, Wright is a two-time USWA World Unified Heavyweight Champion, a one-time WWF Intercontinental Champion, a one-time WWF Tag Team Champion with Bull Buchanan. That was in the Good Father days. I remember that. He headlined Saturday night's main event 31 against Bret Hart for the WWF Championship, and I'm guessing that's as Papa Shango.
Okay. Yep.
That was Bret Hart versus Papa Shango. And then also, Wright was inducted into the WWE Hall of Fame on April 2nd. So it was almost the just past the anniversary of him getting in the Hall of Fame under the Godfather gimmick. So
Godfather.
Shout out to Charles Wright.
Charles Wright, you are my dude, bro. Hey, man, you came into San Jose, had a drink with us, and talked some shit. It was dope, bro. He a dope dude, man.
Cool brother right there, man. Yeah. Cool brother.
All right, man. So that's pretty much all we got for
that's today. All we had a doozy on this one, man.
That's that. Yeah, it was a doozy. We had to get out of there while the getting was still good.
So. Yeah.
Rated R, man. Tell them where they can find you at, brother.
Man, you can find me on all social media platforms at R8TD_R. Where can they find you at RVS?
Yes, sir. My name is RVS, and you can find me on social media platforms at FrenchIce06, FranchIce06. Again, you're listening to the We Coming For You cast.
Sir.
If you want to give us some questions, send those out to WeComingForYouCast@gmail.com, and that's coming without the G.
Yep.
Or hit us up on Twitter, WCFYCast, or Rated R, where can they find us online?
They can find us, and this is a real ad. This is a shoot. You can find us at ProWrestlingBlack.org. Again,
yes, sir.
ProWrestlingBlack.org. Yes, that motherfucker was out there. We snatched it.
We snatched it for $12 a year.
Yeah. Can't beat that with a stick.
Not at all. All right, y'all. We appreciate y'all for listening. Once again, keep it tuned to all the other shows on the SOLC Network.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You know, we got commentary coming soon. We got the scenario remix, the breaking down music and all that good stuff. So keep it tuned here, and we'll holler at y'all next time.
Peace out.
Peace.
You want it? You got it. You want me to get crazy? I'll get crazy. Get out of apologizing. For what? You get out of fight 3 guys? 3 guys trying to kill me? I'm a gang member, baby. Remember that?